Genetic studies confirm that modern-day Palestinians descend from the earliest hunter-gatherer and farmer populations that inhabited the Levant region over 10,000 years ago. Other Bronze and Iron Age civilizations that emerged in the region, like the Canaanites, Phoenicians, Israelites, and Philistines, also left genetic imprints in today's Palestinian gene pool. Study published in the journal Cell focused on the DNA of ancient Philistines. The results suggested that Palestinians descend in part from the ancient Philistines who lived in the same region over 3,000 years ago. The study received some criticism, but overall provided new genetic insights into the ancestors of modern populations in the Levant region. For instance, Jews exhibit more European genetic ancestry in their paternal lineages, likely due to European male converts integrating into Jewish communities. On the other hand, Palestinians show a greater mix of Egyptian, Arabian, and sub-Saharan African genes, reflecting the historical movements and interactions within the Levant region.
One of the most disturbing and surreal aspects of this ongoing genocide is not only that we're able to witness it happen in real time, but that so much of the evidence of the atrocities that are being committed are being posted online by the perpetrators. When I see the countless videos of Israeli soldiers dancing on ruins, claiming they're going to build houses where Palestinians were massacred, or sharing their excitement at leveling the homes of 2 million people, I can't help but think to myself, did you mean to say that? Did you mean to say the quiet part out loud? Usually, one of the hardest things to prove in cases of genocide is intent. But with Israel, it seems like they were never taught that this murderous language should be hidden. It seems like they were taught that there is nothing wrong with it. The evidence of bigotry is only hidden when there isn't mass acceptance of the bigotry. And in this case, it clearly doesn't need to be hidden. And that, to me, is the most nauseating. If you want to read what's being said by Israeli military, Israeli officials, and Israeli media, check out the link to South Africa's application to the International Court of Justice, which is 84 pages long, where they charge Israel with genocide, and they have compiled all of the evidence. It's definitely worth reading, and you can find the link to it in my bio.
For those who complain that we don't share enough about what is going on at home, here's your opportunity to engage. And yes, you read that headline right. 215 bodies were found in unmarked graves behind a Mississippi jail. So let me backtrack and then bring you on to present day. In March, this woman, Betterston Wade, reported that her son, Dexter Wade, was missing. She had later found that not only was he not missing, but that a police officer ran him over and buried him in an unmarked grave. He was buried with identification in his pocket while his mother searched for him for 7 months. And another one, his name was Mario Moore. He died in February. He was buried in July, and his family didn't find out any of it until October. 215 people disposed of like they were just trash, when they had families and loved ones that could have been readily available to pick up their bodies and give them a proper burial. And to add insult to the injury, they didn't even bother to embalm any of the bodies. So the bodies were just placed in bags and into the ground in shallow graves to the point where it created a stench. So when people say that there's no correlation about what's happening overseas and what's happening in the United States, yes, there is. And if you look, this article isn't dated for 2023 or 2024. This was in 2014. My ultimate prayer is that all of these families receive justice, because this is not okay. And I guarantee you that Jackson, Mississippi is not the only place in the United States of America where this is happening.
I'm gonna go to Gaza, Gaza City, the north of Gaza Strip, and visit my grandma's grave, because she died in the genocide in the first month. By the way, my grandmother was just a strong woman. She's a strong woman, and I just looked like her. She was strong. But the thing is, you know, an old woman, and it's not okay for her just to move from here to here. She was displaced 3 times. And the last time was to Shifa Hospital. And because of the crowded places around here, and she could not even have some space to breathe well, to see the sunshine, to eat well. She probably caught an infection also. She passed away. I loved her a lot. And I was so, so, like, angry that we did not have enough time to grieve. Yeah, she passed away. So I'm gonna visit her grave. This is the first thing I'm gonna do. Inshallah.
Zionists is trying to convince people that the state of Palestine and Palestinians never existed because, look, they didn't create their flag until 1964 is literally a page straight out of the colonizers' playbook. And colonizers educate their masses in an effort to try to convince the masses that they had full ownership and claim to this land. So they'll say, look, we created our flag in 1948. They created their flag in 1964. So obviously, we have full right and ownership to this land. And I want people to understand that the need and the necessity to create countries and borders and national anthems and flags only became a necessity because of colonization. If we look at India, Pakistan, and Bangladesh, this used to be a subcontinent. It was not a country. It was a subcontinent. And it was made up of kingdoms, okay? Because of colonization, countries had to be made. So India didn't create a flag until 1947. Pakistan didn't create a flag until 1947. Bangladesh didn't create a flag until 1972. If we look at America, America was made up of tribes. The Navajo Nation didn't create a flag until, I believe, 1968. Nigeria, also another country that was made up of tribes, they didn't create a flag until 1959. So does that mean that colonizers had full right to come and claim their land? Like, I want people to understand, like, the way colonizers argue, it's from a colonizer's standpoint. It's from a book that was written by colonizers. And the need to create borders, the need to create flags and national anthems, these are all things that became a necessity because of colonization.
I really think some lower support need autistics need a fucking reminder that every right we have and every accommodation that we have has been built on the backs and the suffering of people with higher support needs. The lateral ableism and the fight for holistic attention, holistic validation will not save you. You are not safe for them as a lower support need autistic, because every time they come for and they show ableism towards a higher support need autistic, which if you go online, the amount that you will see on videos and comments of people with higher support needs is absolutely horrific. For example, look at a creator like Mia iPad Kid, and that's the carers of Mia who post that content, and the just rampant and horrific things that are said in the comments. First of all, that "is it acoustic" thing is not fucking funny anymore. There were times when it was funny, times when I've seen that joke used well, and now it's just turned into another fucking way to be ableist. It's horrific. And the amount of comments that you see referring to them as a thing, as an it, which is horrific anyway. Or when you see what's recently happened with Sienna, another autistic Aussie, who has posted a video of them on New Year's Eve watching Bluey, I mean, accused of being fucking faking it because they were showing autistic joy and not being masked. And while I don't like people making stupid fucking ableist jokes in their own home and to each other in bloody holistic communities, whatever, it pisses me off. I think it reinforces ableism, but that's different to going online and commenting that on the comments of a creator. There is an actual person behind those screens. I think a lot of people on the internet seem to forget that. And when we, as lower support need autistics, sit there and we condone it or we laugh along with it, we are the ones who are next. And if basic empathy and compassion don't motivate you to care about what's happening to these high support need autistic creators and their families, will you care if I tell you that you're next? If you are a lower support need autistic, you're not fucking safe from them either. And every time that their ableism is legitimised against a high support need autistic, ableism against you is legitimised too. The validation of holistic people and being one of the good ones, one of the cool ones, it will not save you. And it will not get you the reasonable adjustments that you need. It is the most important thing as any member of any marginalised community to pay attention to those who are most marginalised. That is how we save ourselves. Because until there is justice and there is safety for them, there will not be justice and safety truly for the rest of us. And this doesn't just apply to the autistic community, by the way. This is basic kind of marginalised group shit. If you're, for example, talking about, I have physical disability, I use a walking stick. I pay attention to the access needs of somebody who is a wheelchair user or to the access needs of wheelchair users generally, and I fight for that. I don't just sit here and go, well, I can do a couple of steps, so it's okay that you have a couple of steps in your building. I say that's actually not accessible. I talk about the other aspects of it, talk about disabled toilets and actually the fact that you should have a chain place toilet, etc, etc, etc. When you are in these spaces and when you're advocating, you can't just sit there and advocate for yourself, because all it becomes is just a blah, 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 all about yourself. You have to think about the most marginalized as well. Yes, speak on your own experience, yes, speak on your own stories and fight for your own things, but don't just do that and forget about the most marginalized, because they are the key parts of our fight. And I'm not even gonna fucking comment on holistic people, because some of the shit that I see out there sickens me. If you are an holistic person, please be an ally to autistic people. Please don't go around fucking fake claiming autistic people and going, you're not autistic because you're not autistic because unless you actually know that they're faking, then you're just doing harm. You are just doing harm. And sorry, but you know, oh, they're faking and they're going to take, they're self-diagnosing, they're going to take away resources from actual autistic people. What fucking resources? What resources? Please tell me as an autistic person exactly what those resources are, because I seem to be missing them. And all of the resources that I do know about, very few actually require a diagnosis. Self-diagnosis is fine, because they recognise that not every autistic person has access to a diagnosis, and that's fine. Don't try and fight on our behalf and the grandstand on our behalf without actually listening to what we say. And that's not just what people with low support needs say. Listen to all autistic people if you can. Go out of your way to research and listen to people with high support needs and their families and caregivers, because for those of us who can't access social media, which is the case for some people with high support needs and actually quite a lot of people with high support needs, you know, you need to listen to their caregivers, because that's the only way you're going to hear what that person has to communicate to you.
Don't do this when you go to Scotland's beautiful forests. It's not lucky at all, but more and more visitors have been hammering coins into trees and stumps due to a growing trend to make pagan-like offerings for wishes. These deadwood trees and decaying logs don't always look very attractive, and people have taken to punching the coins in as part of their visit. Stop doing this. The National Trust for Scotland has said that forcing coins into the deadwood is causing unnecessary trouble for forest rangers. But why are these old trees so important? The deadwood supports forest ecosystems through processes such as soil nutrient cycling. Plus, lots of species of birds, insects and fungi use them for shelter and to rear their young. These money trees are predominantly bashed with UK pennies, though there's quite a few coins from overseas, especially American dimes and various cents from Europe. Tree coins are causing a lot of trouble for our magical woodlands. Instead, why not donate your coins to the Forest Trust so they can use them to conserve wildland?
So y'all saw the video of the white doctor being casually anti-black. You saw it, I saw it, and some people said some insightful stuff about it. I'm just mad. I lost my grandfather 20 years ago due to medical racism. And I'm in a very odd position where I have the privilege of not really having to deal with that at all. But I have watched and I have grieved with my family for the past 20 years, my grandfather, just because a doctor decided he didn't want to really do his job like that. What aggravates me is knowing that it wasn't really a decision like that. I know it wasn't. I know it was a subconscious thing, probably in his head, that he was like, okay, it's a black guy. I don't really actually feel the need to, like, waste my time right now. He's like, oh, it's just not worth it. Okay, so I can just, you know, give him advice and be at home, and he'll be fine, you know? And the subconscious thought process was probably, okay, black man, less value, not worth my time. You know? And I know that. I know that. But that's why people harp on the idea of, like, being like, okay, you really need to check your subconscious, because it costs somebody their life. The medical racism in the video that we saw cost patients their lives. I will never have a conversation with my grandfather. Ever. I will never meet the version of my mom who was soft, who was protected by her father. I will never meet that version of my mom ever. I will never meet the version of my grandmother that was so beautifully loved by this man. Because doctors like this are still allowed to practice. Because doctors don't have to learn to treat Black people with humanity. Because it's just, like, accepted. And I'm at a point where, you know, like, I have the weird privilege of I not being as affected by it. Because I'm in the South, so I'm not even really viewed as Black like that. No, I'm mixed. Shocked. We're shocked. But I've seen it affect every part of my family. Even my birth. My mom was stitched up. Felt every bit of it because nobody believed her pain. And I lived up north. So that's a different racial situation there. Okay. And I remember having to advocate for myself relentlessly for pain medication. I remember seeing my mom, who's a doctor, by the way, having to advocate when she was in the ER. And I was the only one that was there with her. And so I was 17 and I was so scared. And I just had to see my mom advocate for herself. If she couldn't drive, I had to drive her. My mom was like almost incapacitated. I remember having to see her. And thank God she did, because she had a brain tumor. But after ignoring that migraine pain, because nobody took it seriously for years. And I almost lost my mom. I know we're not supposed to be, like, that emotional when we're talking about this stuff. You know, we're supposed to, like, get a point across or be educational. But you know what? Fuck that. Fuck that. Because every day of my life is impacted by this. And the thing is, this the medical racism that affects us, you know, that's normal. That is just an average Black experience. I'm not special. My family's not unique. There's just like almost every Black family, like we're all affected by it. You know, which is why even though I individually am usually not impacted, I feel it. You know, like and it pisses me the fuck off. Because so many people, like, try to brush it under the rug because they're uncomfortable by it. Or they don't even want to fucking listen. Like, these doctors, like, I saw this doctor on my For You page. I saw that video on my For You page after having a conversation with my mom where she was talking about she's getting close to the age my grandfather was when he was killed. And how she was, you know, worried about her approaching that time, and we're talking about her medical history because I almost said I wanted to take her to the ER again. And she was worried about making it. And I saw this show up on my For You page and I wept because I saw that man. I was like, you look like the man that took my grandfather from me. You look like the man that my mom was relentlessly fighting against in the ER. I don't know, watching that video, it felt like I was hearing the internal monologue of the doctor that took my grandfather from me. I was like, okay, that's what it was then like. I saw that doctor, and I was like, okay, that's what he's thinking. That was what he were thinking. Anyways, to those of y'all who are actually making educational content about medical racism, thank you for going to bat for all of us. Thank you. I see y'all's videos. I am so thankful. I don't really have the spoons right now, but I see y'all, and y'all are doing great. Y'all are really holding on the fort. Good on y'all. Yeah.
The Tigray people are dying. In fact, they're under a famine that is worse than ever before. After the Silent War, which has led to a genocide that has killed over 600,000 Tigrayans and left millions displaced, food security was never ensured in Tigray. I have even lost family members due to the war. The famine is mainly caused by drought and the effects of the late war. It could even be compared to the Great Famine, which has cost the lives of millions of Ethiopians. In fact, 5.2 million Tigrayans are in need of emergency aid, while 2.3 million Tigrayan children are in need of humanitarian care. More people are dying every day, and a lot of us are not even aware of this. Plus, nobody deserves to deal with famine after witnessing a horrible war. So please spread awareness and share this video. Thank you for watching.
You said it. There are people to this day, how could we let the Library of Alexandria burn down? How could we let some of the oldest archives and libraries in the world be bombed?
New laws are being introduced that will bring back the criminalization of homelessness.
Oh, yeah. Nah, it makes sense why they're letting all them rapists and pedos back out.
Wow, okay, so many thoughts. So that's actually not really what's happening. That is called being corralled, where the police block off streets in front of you and around you. And what that actually does is undermine the point of a protest. I think some of us have forgotten the plot a little bit. Protests are meant to be disruptive. They are meant to be annoying. They are meant to shut things down. When we yell, shut it down, what we mean actually by those words is shut it down. I don't know where this whole big trend of like organizing and including the police came from, but I, for one, don't like it. The police are not on your side. When we say ACAB, we are talking about a bastardized system that they are upholding. There may be a cop who is like good on the, I don't know, but there is no such thing as like a situationally, like systemically good cop. You are not being protected, you are being corralled.
You mean the American troops? Because I agree with you there. Or Israel. They do it too, for sure. Nice catching up, buddy.
Not to be that person, but as more and more people, especially colored people, start calling for like the downfall, the demise of the United States, I think it's good that we recognize that the systems in place can't be reformed into something better. They have to be dismantled. But what you're calling for, the complete just like erasure of the United States, is going to impact colored people last. And we don't have the social structures, the community care, the support to actually support the people who would be most impacted. What you're calling for is to sacrifice them. For example, when people say we should just give up and stop supporting the United States and stop paying our bills and our rent and our taxes that go into some resources that people need, the people most immediately and drastically impacted are going to be disabled people. And I know y'all are not prepared to offer the kind of community support and care and resources that disabled people are going to need to survive, which means that you're essentially saying, sorry, champ. The same thing holds true for people, let's say, in poverty. Y'all say things like, don't pay your rent, but we don't have a plan for what happens when the people who don't have any savings don't pay their rent and end up homeless. Because y'all aren't going to support them. Y'all don't like people who are unhoused now. And I know that this call for dismantling the structures in the United States that are holding all of us back comes from a genuine place and a historical one. People have been calling for this for years. But all these extra steps when people are encouraging others to like not pay their rent or their taxes or their whatever isn't coming from a well-organized community-based place. And it's going to get a lot of people hurt, namely people who are not middle to upper class colored people.
I am sure 90% of you Gen Zs on TikTok don't even know what apartheid means. The term apartheid, which comes from South Africa.
Horrendous. That is so sad. They're so beautiful, but they are wearing horrible outfits.
We're at my mom's South Asian boutique. I want you to tell them what you would make those two twins wear at the Yule Ball. And we're going to show a bunch of different options.
Okay.
This is one of our options for the twins. This is called a lehenga.
They were not wearing lehenga. They were wearing disastrous lehenga. These are called sharara saris. So they are sharara with a crop top and with a sari.
Pants.
Yep.
You think this would look really good on them? It's fun to have them in different shades of pink. It doesn't have to always be like complementary colors.
Remember, you're wearing Indian clothes. Indians are full of color and passion.
The last option we're going to show you, if they were like bougie Indian twins, this is what they would have worn to the Yule Ball. This is what we would want them to wear if they went all out for the Yule Ball.
This is again lehenga and choli, which represents our Indian culture. Beauty of India.
To sacrifice my own life for
India. There was no color, there was no style. There are such beautiful colors and styles in our store for Indian clothing. I mean, we are full of color and life and passion. So they should have showed that instead of making them wear what they were wearing.
She thinks that I owe her an apology. Good thing she don't get paid for thinking.
What carat is this?
10 carat, 150 stones. It has 2 pink diamonds.
So how many African children do you think were unalived in the process of making that necklace? Because that's probably 1 per stone. Oh my God, so luxurious. You know, all of this bloodshed on my neck. And on top of that, you tried to ignore the existence of all of the comments talking about how those are all blood diamonds. Girl, if you have enough audacity to showcase that much bloodshed, at least be able to speak about it.
Because it's iconic. And I love to do iconic shit.
Does it taste like genocide, though?
No, because I'm glad we're talking about it, because it truly doesn't make any sense. Because when Sam Wilson was first introduced as Captain America, they did not give it as much push as they did with Captain Carter. They made Captain Carter a whole icon for their Twitter for a real hot minute, and they centered a comic around this girl. As far as I know, nobody asked for this chick to begin with. And while I do agree her concept was cool in What If, I really liked her episodes, but you should be pushing Sam way more. You should be pushing a character for your TV show when this dude is supposed to be the main factor. This is Captain America. And when Falcon and the Winter Soldier got so much pushback from its discussions about racism and its discussions about Sam being Captain America, a black Captain America, it should have got even way more pushback to firmly stand like, hey, this is our Captain America. You could like it or get out. You know what I'm saying? Chris Evans, the former Captain America, shouldn't have to do that for y'all. That's all I gotta say.